और जयमा। The innumerable tireless and perennial search, survey and service of all humans of various parts of the world is only to develop and establish the management process of their lives. So, today's topic is the essence of life of all human beings, all advanced people, because except human beings, somehow all the other species, due to their inherence and adherence to nature, they used to manage their lives, provided that they are not disturbed by human beings. So, the life management is the essence, is the vitality and destination for each and every human being in the globe. Especially in this era of development and progress, more they realize, just as they realize the value of the shadow when they are moving around red hot sun, as the management skills have been eroded and alloyed by means of unwanted desires and delusions, now they crave for the real management of their life more than what they had in the pre-civilization years. To start with, basically all living organisms, they have survival mechanism. The survival mechanism is bifold. It has functional mechanism that is embedded in security. How to execute the functions? What are the external resources that are required for execution of the biological function? And how to be against the hurdles or the external factors or obstacles that could intrude the process of biological functioning? So this survival and defense mechanism, how to live and how to continue or withstand one stage of life amidst hurdles. This type of instinct, they only in advanced status, they gained super speciality in the name of skills branded as administration, governance and management. So all of these various skills what we see now, they have blossomed from the basic survival mechanism which consisted of the functional and defense status which is embedded pre-inhibitively in each and every organism of our species. Now this management, it was started in the year of the academic recognition as well as development to deal with people, to manage a lot of people, to manage a lot of activities, to manage resources. So whenever there is multitude and magnitude, whenever there is a testoon of varieties wherein we have to amalgamate everything for a common productive cause, the science of management emerged. How to handle people, manpower resources, financial management, trade management, foreign trade management, international business management. And the same thing has emerged in now, you see, now we are being asked by some universities to frame a syllabus for MBA temple management. Now there is hospital management and IT administration and IT management is there. And even after one or two decades, it may not be surprising if we have MBA in house management, children management, team management, etc. Because whatever we have gained through tradition, we have gained these things through tradition. Now we are in a pitiable state to gain the same thing through teaching and training. We had these instincts in our inherence. Now we have to go for reference and rehearsals. So this shows how deplorable and degradable the status of human being and how pseudomorphic the structure of the so-called science and technology and its development that we boast that we have now. So we can understand these things. So to repeat it for easy grasping and understanding, whatever we had by inherence, the same inherence is replaced by reference and rehearsals. Whatever we had through tradition, the same thing must be now replaced by teaching and training processes. So now life management, what do you mean by life management? It is managing one's own life. Very simple. But what is life and what is management and how to execute it? According to Shastra as well as the modern biological explanations and elucidations, life is nothing but it is connected with periodicity. It is connected with the tenure. It is a tenure contract. According to our traditional wisdom, life is the soul body contract. It is a contract of the soul with the body. And according to biology, it is a contract of the driving force, which is there in different forms of systems, organs, there are tissues and channels, with a perfect organism. So, an organism driving force, or a soul body or a spirit body contract, that sojourning period or tenure is what we call life. Number one. And life has various other modules to study. One is the design, life design. Second is the desire. Third thing is the demand. Fourth thing is the duty. And fifth thing is the destination. These five things we used to call it as 5 Ds, or pentastructural dimension of spiritual sojourn inside this mundane sheath or coil. The design is how we have to live by means of the systems of central nervous system, digestion system, circulatory system, various other systems are there. This is the design of life. Then desire of life. Then what do you want? Demand, what others want from you. Duty, what you ought to do. Destination, what is the end of this process? Is the completion the conclusion, or there is a repetition possibility by which there is a cyclic chain by which perpetually you have to go through this process, or there is an end after the death? So biological death includes bred death and functional death, and eschatology is a philosophical division that deals with life after death and repatriation, etc. Innumerable these things are governed under the system of destination. So these 5 major things, the design of living, the desire, the demand, the duty and destination, we have to understand in life management. The design is preset. All the other things we have to understand in life management principles. And third thing, you know that basically we have read in our books also, social sciences, that food, shelter and clothing, these are the basic amenities of life. And no doubt it is very, very common, and you know that food, respiration and shelter is common for all organisms. They used to have their own things. But clothing, it is just the primary agent which distinguishes the human being from the other species. And there are innumerable things that are the distinguishable factors which are very rarely found now. But clothing is a very visible and conspicuous distinguishable factor which differentiates human beings from other people. Now also we see lot of cartoon characters and pets which are wearing sophisticated clothing more than the human beings also. So these basic amenities, they have expanded. They have expanded. In the course of this expansion, new products are informed. Accessibility, possession and maintenance. So to get those resources, we have to earn. To earn, we have to learn. So this is the ladder of civilization or ladder of management. So products increase by expansion, and resources ought to be increased. And to increase the resources, the methodology of learning must be maintained, for which there must be a system of learning. This is the second ladder, apart from clothing, shelter and other things, etc. So what do you mean by expansion? Expansion is manifold. Expansion means expansion due to evolution, civilization, migration and trade, colonization, population increase. Then expansion due to maturity, development and progress in science and technology. This has increased a lot of requests in the society, which has created a new race. What is the new race known as? It is known as a demand race and desire race. The more desire is running, the demand is also running. The more the desire is running, demand is running, and demand is running, desire is running. So by a mutual lock and a mutual dependability, the desire as well as the demand, that has an aimless race and continuously running without having proper destination, without having proper even deserving nature. So this is the status now. We are going to start learning or thinking about the art of life management. So in this base, in this expansion area, now it is our duty to understand, as well as we have to equip ourselves with the demands and desires, where to control, where to augment, where to process, which to avoid. This type of prudential, this type of sagacious study of the situation and balancing one's own equilibrium, and also catering to the needs of one's real life and also showing a pathway to others, it is known as life management now. So life management, it starts with 2 models. One is a fertile model, second is a fascination model. What is fertile model? If there is knowledge, if there is quality, if there is work, if there is opulence, If you imitate that and cultivate the same thing inside you, that is a fertile model. If there is mere status, comfort and style of life, without imitating the other requisites that are there, on which the foundation of that development is installed, if you just copy a person's status, comfort and other things and strive to get those things, that is a fascination model. Now the era is running only with fascination model, without cultivating the fertility of deserving nature and qualifying one's own self to get eligibility and procurability and withstandability of the resources, the financial status, or person is blindly just after the fascinations. That is the present model. So the fascination model must be converted. I delivered a lecture on dream and reality of national security, and before talking about national security, I told that dream and reality, they are not different from each other. A person who is energetic, his dream is a pre-status for his reality, and reality is the mature status of his dream. And for a person who is hypnotic or artistic, his life will run only in dreams. So somebody asked there about national security, how you are going to make this dream a reality. Then I told that I am not going to make your dream a reality. You people, due to lack of integration and proper methodology of approach, you are making this reality of national security a dream. So everything is possible. It may take some time, it may take mega transformation, mass renaissance, which may be made by the trampling of these ugly elements and ugly heads under the titanic feet of a tremendous and turbulent energy. So that turbulent source was to emerge in the society by our contemplation, execution and integrity. That's what I told. So to start with the human life, he starts with his family. As an individual, he has his family, his parents. Then the family is made, that is the wife and children, which he creates, which he assembles. That is his own family. Then he has his associates, relations and other friends. So this is known as sub-society. First, each and every human being is connected with sub-society as an individual, then with his family, the parenthood, then with his wife and children, then the relations and that thing. And even now, they have more affinity towards possessions and pets. Pets are also now part of the family. And they love more the possessions rather than the parents and other people. So this thing is known as sub-society. A limited portion of the society in which the person is attached. And second thing is the mega society, or the broader society, or the wider society. In this wider society, we see lot of people. We are seeing living environment, we are having learning environment, and we are having professional environment where we earn and settle our lives. So academic, professional and neighborhood. Neighborhood means where we have connections, where we have mutual discussions, where we have transactions, where we have mutual service exchanges. That is known as neighborhood, living environment. That is also second society. Then we have learning environment like the school, colleges and tuition center. Then we have also professional environment. Then matrimonial environment, I have already told. That is also a form of sub-society. These are small clusters. Unless we understand these things and there are specific difficulties, to manage the life is just to write in a book and read it loud, and it cannot produce anything practically. So these are the various clusters of the society. Then the third society is a very big society with a lot of odds, with a lot of cleavages and disparities. We have a society which is being fragmented in names of language, in names of parties, in names of caste and race, in names of regions and religions. So it is a mega society, or it is a wider society. And there are two problems. If you belong to the same clan or same group, it will create jealousy, friction between like-minded people or like-located people. That is known as homogeneous friction and heterogeneous friction. If a person belongs to the same caste, any person belonging to the same caste, instead of developing affinity, he may develop jealousy, which may result in hostility and disturbance. It is known as homogeneous friction. And naturally, if even homogeneous friction is there, heterogeneous friction is inescapable. So, due to the behavioral mismanagement of emotions of living beings, even if a person belongs to his own kind, he is subjected to turmoil. Even if a person is different, this emerges from jealousy to hostility, that from hatredness to hostility. But both the thing ends in hostility only. So it is a social error, it is a psychological error, it is a systemic error. So unless a person knows about all of these things and management issues, he cannot come for management at all. So what is management? Innumerable explanations have been given for management, but contextually, simply, as well as exhaustively, I want to give a definition for this. Number one, anything will move only by a driving force which is in the form of resources. That might be internal resources, external resources, individual resources, instrumental resources, technical resources, collective resources, subtle resources, tangible resources, whatever it may be. How to get the resources? What to do for the resources? What to do with the resources? And how to manage or how to exist without the resources? These three things are the questions for which the answer is management. What to do for the resources? What to do with the resources? And how to exist in spite of the absence of the so-called distinct or determined resources? And there are some interim stages between these three major questions. Between with and without, there are two things. One is inefficiency, second thing is insufficiency. Even if you possess something, that may be inefficient, that may be insufficient. Even adversity comes in between with and without. We cannot either say that we are having this or we are not having this. We are having this thing, but in adversity. So management is a skill. It is a masculine skill of a person's culmination of psycho-intellectual and spiritual strategy, as well as the robust nature of a person's execution skill, by which a person can understand sociological, psychological, and ecological factors and derive at a conclusion in which the person is prosperous or at least safe. This is known as management. So management deals with the issues of for the resources, with the resources, and without the resources, even in cases of insufficiency, inefficiency, and adversity. The qualities that are required, the four pillars for management, according to Shastras. One is ambience. One should have a proper ambience, environmental favor. Second thing is endurance, the withstanding ability. Third thing is patience, to wait for the time and process. Fourth thing is potency, the inherent ability to withstand all these things, not mere desire to withstand, but also the ability. So these things are the major qualities. So how we are going to start this management? There are two issues, health and happiness. Health and happiness are the first basic couplet on which all the other developments and managements are constructed. Happiness is an internal perfect tool model, and health is the external perfect tool model. If the external tools are complete, perfect, cooperative, amicable, and workable or efficacious, that is what we call health. And the same thing, if it is there, the inner resources, that is known as happiness. And health and happiness is different on the basis of different persons' accessibility, their affordability, their consideration. This creates a lot of diversities and various depths and dimensions in finalizing what is happiness. There is a science of eudaimonics. Eudaimonics is a Vedic science which deals with the process of reserving, preserving, conserving, applying and distributing happiness. Like melancholics are there, agathology is there, aritology is there. So lot of other unexplored regions of the traditional science. We have to conduct a lot of workshops, at least we have to prepare a syllabus and educate these people along with the other called burdens which they are carrying on their heads, emptying their brains. So this major system of happiness, how to get? And health, how to get? There are some levels told in Shastra, it is quite interesting, to have, to get, to achieve and to accomplish. For example, progeny. You know that progeny is very common, and India is very much renowned for the progeny revolution and evolution. And it is the only sorrow for India is that it could not compete or excel China. So progeny is very common. So for those who are inherently, inbuiltly getting those resources, it is to have it. For those people who try, it is to get it. For those people who struggle, it is to achieve it. For those who it is impossible to get it, is to accomplish it. Naturally, the smooth way of getting things is to have it. I have two children. Means it is a very smooth process. I get two children means by observing some fasting, some methodology, some diet, some restriction, some medication, it is to get it. Even if it is challengeable to one's own getting by means of observations, then to achieve it by a struggle. If it is humanly impossible, by penance, contemplation, austerity and ritualistic methodologies, accomplish it. So, To have it and to accomplish it depends upon the person, not in the issue. The same person may be having dozens of children without any effort, any extra effort. And for the same thing, to get one children, that is a pair of children or one child for any other people who are having some sort of impact in their structure, it is an achievement. For some people who are totally negated and nullified by doctors for the possibility of getting a progeny, it is an accomplishment. So, the management says how to have things normally and how to get things by your effort and how to achieve things by means of an instrumental support and how to get things by means of a metaphysical support. So, one is to procure by effort, second is support, third thing is instrumental support, fourth thing is mega-technical or meta-technical or metaphysical effort or metaphysical support. So, to have, to get and to achieve and accomplish. These are all the major issues in health and happiness. So, if we have to be healthy and we have to be happy, it is the nature of us. If we don't have it, we have to get it. If we cannot get it, we have to achieve it. If we cannot achieve by our instrumental, collective, scientific and technological methods, certainly we have to take shelter into the spiritual asylum, wherein by means of the gracious penetration of the transcendental authorities and delegates of the spiritual lineage and scriptural lineage should radiate you with their divine bestowal by which we can accomplish it. So, the management deals whether we have to get it, or we have it, or we have to achieve it, or to accomplish it. These four models are very much important. On seeing some other person we could not try, or we should not blindly follow some other model which is not suitable for us. So, this is the education, basic education for life management. And this type of stress and strain, how much you work, how long you have to wait, how much you can gain, this is based on a person's status. It is based on a person's stage, it is based on a person's surroundings, this is based on even the sequential order. The strain for a person who is with more sin, it will be more than a normal person. For example, a responsibility of a person to drive a car is different from the responsibility of a traffic constable to guide number of cars. So it is a stage and that is status and this is surroundings. For example, if a person is driving, the same person driving amidst rain, heavy rain, mist and lack of clarity, that is something which is connected with more induced stress. So that is surrounding and sequential order. How you take, what is your response, that is also there. In Mumbai, bomb blasting was there. It was a feast to the news agencies. And no doubt, it is a loss to Mumbai economy. It is a personal loss of building a structure and various things to the concerned owners of the buildings. And it is a target or aim or life mission for the terrorists. The same thing is a turmoil for the victims. So it is not a sequential impact. The same thing, the level of impact, it is different between various issues for various persons. For government, it is responsibility. It is lack of responsibility and the responsibility to install their own responsibility. So for government, they are answerable to the society. News agencies, it is just one more headline in their, that is what we call one more feather in their cap. It is a mega incident that has wider coverage and more sensation and attraction to the society. Whereas the same sequential impact for a person who has lost their lives or who is connected with the family, certainly it is a great turmoil. So this impact, life management, we cannot create a common cause. We cannot make hasty generalization. What is the impact of your surroundings? What is the impact of the sequential order and what is your status or what is your stage and what is the impact for that? And one more question, how to get these management skills? According to Shastra, they say that it is possible by tradition, paramparagata jnana. So it can be given by tradition, it can be given by parental or academic tuition, it may be given by a receptorial transmission, it may be by intuition, it may be by experience and transformation, it may be by repetition and realization and rectification. So there are six major ways. If you get from your family sources, that is known as tradition. The second thing is to get through a proper way of education. Somebody is educating you how to handle issues. That is known as tuition. Transmission is a divine gift. It is a sanction of divine radiation. And it may be even by transformation, on experiencing the observations of other people or observing the experiences of other people, we are learning from them and we are transforming ourselves from learning from others. And the final thing is repentance, realization, rectification. Unless we we subject ourselves to such melancholy, such a disorder or a disastrous calamity, we don't realize. So the possibilities for getting into life management is to, by tradition, by fusion, by intuition, transmission, transformation, repulsion and realization. These are the ways. Then there is a question which is frequently asked by most of the people. It must be philosophically dealt. Do we have in our life something known as selection, option and intervention? Can we select something as per our will? What is selection? There is a random cluster of varieties of things. So amidst that heap of varieties, you can have your own thing. That is known as selection. Option is, there is a limited version that is available before you, which is a medley of varieties. Amidst that destined or predetermined varieties, you can have a limited selection, which is known as option. How far I can intervene in my life, how far I can select, how far I can opt for things, how far I can deal with the process of intervention. And there is one more question which is connected with the destinal mathematics. They ask this question, number one, are we selected by people? Are we selected by forces? Are we selected by a power? It is very interesting to know, if we have a job, a rational and natural way of thinking is, I have selected a job. If somebody has opted for engineering, they think that they have selected engineering. It is a natural, common, obvious way. And in spiritual way, or as per distinctive mathematics, you have not selected that, and that answers that, that particular division has selected you. That particular thing has opted you. And instead of your intervention into your own activities as per your own desire and design, there is an intervention of a second force apart from all of your visible forces, like trend analysis, market analysis, then management, administration, then organizational behavior, then investment mechanics, fund management, resources management. In spite of having all of these visible trends without any flaw, there is something which is guiding you, there is something which is deviating you, there is something that is intervening in your way apart from whatever the thing that you consider as a perceptible tool for your development and survival. So this type of understanding of selection, option and intervention in two dimensions. Are we selected? Are we opted? Are we intervened in spite of all perfect and precise in our status? Number one. Number two, can we have an option, selection and intervention? So there are two dimensions of these things. One is energy physics or entrepreneurship, and second thing is destinal mathematics or the law of karma or predeterminism. And one has to manage both of these things to understand as well as arrive at a proper way of measuring his life status and leading the same without fail. So this particular area that has resulted in understanding of life by five major rules. Number one is law of binding. There is a law by which each and every person is committed to his previous action, the impact of which binds and distains the furtherance. Each and everybody's further action or the impact for his present actions are determined and distained by the cyclic link of previous imprints and impulses. So it is known as law of binding. Second is known as law of qualification. Law of qualification says that there are innumerable methodologies by which a person can observe fasting, certain rites, contemplative methodologies, certain systems of observing celibacy, austerity, mystic practices and getting supernatural accomplishments. A person can have a qualification breaking the rules of demarcations of bindings. That is known as the rule of qualification. The third thing is the rule of subtle refinement, that is what we call samskaras. If a person has to get a proper stage development, what is stage development? A person born, he must be hale and healthy. A student must be intellectually salubrious. And harmony is the benefit of matrimonial relations. Harmony and progeny is the fruit of matrimonial relations. Development, all-round happiness, success and progress, these are all the fruits of business. So all of these things are not only governed by tangible things but also by subtle refinements. They are known as samskaras. So the Shastras say that there are samskaras like Jata Karma, Upanayana and Vivaha itself is a samskara. So considering something as a social contract, or as a blind ceremonial ritual, understanding the purport and purpose of the ritual with the fullest meaning, and have a divine and contemplative attachment with each and every movement of the society that makes the person to get utmost benefits. That is known as the rule of subtle refinement or samskara suddhi. The fourth is the rule of second focus. If you cannot get something, if something is not meant for you, for example, if something is not achieved, immediately there are a lot of people who will be depressed. There are a lot of people who will go for even suicidal motivation. There are a lot of people who will be totally de-socialized, disqualified to live in the society. There are a lot of people who will have a blow of thunder or lightning and it is just momentary. They will re-equip themselves and come to the normalcy. And there are a lot of people who just throw these things away and re-equip themselves with an alternative or substitution, which is a dimension of a survival theory, alternative and substitution. It is a very vital medulla oblongata for survival mechanism. So this type of rule is known as the rule of second focus. If you don't get something, you go for alternative. There are a lot of other things available. There are a lot of people, those who achieved in this society, in science, in athletics, in media, in industrialism, and various other dimensions, a lot of people are there, in spite of their failures, a lot of people withstood. And a lot of people, they totally abdicated their previous stage and entered a new, fresh area, then mastered, achieved, and they are living with enormous repute. So innumerable such models are there available, living models and inspiration models are available. Both history and society has provided a collection of varieties of such people in various industries or various dimensions. If something is not there, you contemplate on something else. Great people, those who have achieved in mega dimensions, like social development and scientific development, personally in their family life or in the sub-society level, those people, they have proved their failure. They have successfully failed in their sub-society level, but in the society level, they have proved their excellence. So this is known as the rule of second focus. If you don't have the thing, you opt for the same thing for a second time. If you don't have a thing, you offer something different, something distinct, something that is essential for the society and achieve it. It is known as the rule of second focus. And rule of intuitive dividends and rule of distant communication or subjective communication, these two things are very much essential in life management. I think that we have conducted workshops on that and it is not a lecture. Rule of intuitive guidance. How to know about things? Experience things which are just tabulated or filtered upon your or others' experience, they are just blind. If somebody cheats you, then that experience induces your caution, and also it paints all people, it brands all people in the name of fraudulence. If some benefit you get, if you get a trace of benefit, then that pinch of benefit that brands everything as fortune to you. For example, in gambling, in horse riding and various other issues, whatever infinitesimal or a scintillating spark that they receive, that makes a person to tempt, to go for everything as beneficial. If a person is totally deceived in a particular atmosphere, that makes a person to totally deal everything in a deceptive model or a deceptive frame. So, intuitive guidance, it gives you a proper way of filtration by which you can analyze where to believe, how much to believe, how long to believe, and what are the selective issues, what are the rational factors that we have to take for our guidance that can be promptly and properly given only by intuitive guidance. I have already told, by your experience, education is useless. By reading in papers, you cannot just do nothing in the practical life, either in business or in organization management. Your paper experience will not come for rescue. Your personal experience is limited. Paper experience is crude. So, divine experience or intuitive experience is the proper and precise guide. So, to repeat it, paper experience is crude. It is raw material. Personal experience is limited and unilateral or unidirective in nature. So, intuitive guidance. How to develop intuition? Intuition is already there in everybody. And to become a good receptacle or a reflector plane of that intuition, that must be constituted by ethical precision and universal love. We know all of these qualities. We know all of these qualities and we have heard them even in the first standard fables and fairy tales and stories even. So how to instill the same thing and how to make a process by which we can be ethically vaccinated. That is known as ethical vaccination. We used to call it as ethical vaccination. So to get a study model in which we tenaciously grip to the principles which we know, which we think, which we dream, which we plan to have, but which we cannot due to various other diversions and centrifugal diversions and dilutions of the society that has made the people, in spite of knowing there is no such person available in the mature and civilized society whom we have to teach about the principles of ethics. Everybody knows everything. What we have to do is we have to create a compulsion within the internal atmosphere that the person practices that thing. That must be created by means of a divine intimacy, a soul intimacy, which makes a person to get a spiritual determination or a moral courage by which the person is ready to face anything for implanting these qualities and emphasizing the same. So only we have to do with the methodology, and methodology is a problem of society, not ideas. We have innumerable books, workshops, lectures, publications, a lot of people to narrate stories. So innumerable resources we have in ideology. So intuitive guidance, it is a very essential thing. Once we have to organize 1 or 2 days workshop, practical workshop on intuitive guidance, how to develop an inner tuition as an assisting factor. It is not a replacement for all of your practical experience. Apart from your practical experience, apart from your knowledgeability in the particular area where you are working and learning, it is a guiding factor, it is a steering factor which takes you to the proper direction and proper destination. So how to develop this intuitive guidance? And finally, there is the rule of subjective communication. Lot of people are there, even the person may be our own son, located within the four walls. We can even advise the president of Iraq or Pakistan, we cannot advise these people. So these how to emphasize the properties of truth, honesty, obedience and other things? You must have done penance, or at least we should have done penance now. And the products of penance will be always precise. And the products of our previous activities, the collection which we call prarabdha, if it is a product of our previous collection, that prarabdha product will be like our prarabdha only, not as per our expectation or not as per our demand for our family development or social development. So then we cannot have direct guidance, then we cannot have direct control, then we cannot implant any rule of obedience by means of our direct speech, direct discussions, debate, dialectical skills and various other things. When all of our physical and oral measures fail, then we have to take the subjective communication which we have to contemplate in our inner mind, which has been proved by great psychiatrists, that a person who is emotionally attached with some person, if he communicates when the person is deep asleep, when he communicates with the person's form in his mental screen projection, or he just she or he just sees the photo or any other symbol, emblem, possession or anything of that person, if he subtly communicates, there are possibilities for gradual or drastic change in their mind structures, in rebuilding relations, creating obedience, in formulation of love and harmony. That is known as the rule of subjective communication or rule of distant communication. So these things are some issues of the life management. Number one, the rule of binding, the karmic theory. Second thing, the rule of qualification, how to qualify one's own self, instead of just desiring for something else, how to qualify one's own nature and sturdity to get the benefit. Third thing is how to subtly refine one's own status by samskaras. Then there is the rule of second focus, then the rule of intuitive guidance, then finally the rule of subjective communication by which we can connect ourselves with hostile element, distant element, unknown element. Even we can contemplate for world peace. They are distant people. People suffering in Afghanistan or in Iraq or in Ethiopia, Somalia, they are distant people and deserving people, downtrodden people. And we, Jammu Kashmir, we can pray for them. That is distant communication. Then hostile communication. Even people for whom we do the good, they may misunderstand and there may be a cleavage between both of us. So for those people also, for distant people, hostile people, and the people of different mentalities, we can bring them together, we can build a bridge of communication by means of this subjective communication methodology. Then first we have to take in various dimensions of life, the first thing is birth and progeny. That is, we are giving birth to our own children, that is progeny. We are born to our parents and that is our birth, that is janma and jayamana. There are two issues in that. And second thing is education, third thing is career development, fourth thing is relation maintenance, fifth thing is professional status, and there are three issues of securities. So as a concluding matter, I want to just precisely as well as concisely mention about these issues and conclude this session. And you know that there are two types of thoughts in the society. We think that being born to our parents and giving birth to our own issues, they are not in our hands. But the Shastra says that if a person, yoga bhrishto abhijayate, so says the Gita, a person who is practicing mystic practices, divine practices, charitable activities, activities of cosmopolitanism and altruism, he is born in good family. Shrimatam, suchinam yehe. So he is born in a traditional family, in a resourceful family, in a serene, unpolluted, unalloyed atmosphere the person is born. So a person's deeds and activities of this time, even the parent, both parents, the parents to whom he is born and being the parents of his own issues. So one can test us now, there is a recent science, emerging science known as the eugenetics. Eugenetics deals with genetic tailoring. Just as you are giving order to your shirt and pant, you can give order to your children. Yes, I want a child who can speak three languages, 6.2 tall, can British complexion, a person skillful in mathematics and logic, hating everybody and loving me. So we can give an order. It is not a genetic tailoring. Likewise in prarthana, by the sanskaras of simantana or simantonnayana, or Pumsavana, we used to call that. So even in Simanta Samskara, or even in the Garbhavana Samskara, even in Vivaha, even in the matrimonial rites, we have Prarthana, we have a lot of methodologies for creating productive child. And I told in seminar, fertility is not only producing children, issues. If it is that is the fertility, then pigs are producing piglets and puppies are produced by dogs and cats produce kittens. So, fertile fertility is producing productive children to the family, to the tradition, to the society, to the nation as a whole. And if you want such type of issues, certainly it is possible only by a spiritual process. So, if a person is having behavioral perfection, then the person has two options or two benefits. One, he can select, qualitatively select the type of family in which he wants to be born, number one. Number two, he can also select the nature or the goodness of his progeny. And if you don't do anything at all, if all the other essentials are totally abdicated, relinquished, and all the unwanted, prohibited things are very meticulously observed, then our progeny will resemble only our fate. So, this is the first thing. In our life management, we can even govern our life, constitutive lifestyles, and also we can govern our progeny. That is possible in divine life management. And second thing is education. You know that education, now the present education is a burden. I have given lot of lectures on education. Education has no realization and relation. Education should have two qualities. The first quality is one should rejoice the education. Second thing, he should realize what he is being educated with. Nobody is realizing what they are doing and nobody is relishing at all. It is an unwanted burden, it is a curse, it is a punishment, except for the graduation certificate as well as the connecting opportunities, abroad settlement, promotion, transfer, etc. The real education, direct connectivity with education is a bitter juice. Nobody enjoys that. Education is neither relishable nor realizable by the modern community. And carried option, everybody, you see, there is a rule known as pseudo-projection. What is pseudo-projection? I told you in an education seminar, everybody is selecting their career on the basis of limitation, imitation, coercion and other various factors. What is limitation model? I know only this faculty, so I want to be educated in that. That is limitation. Imitation, everybody is doing that, mass imitation. Everybody is doing IT, so I have to do IT. So this is an imitation model, competition model. If he can join and study, why can't I? So I am also doing that. That is competition model. Coercion, I wanted to study, I could not. So you study this. My son should study this. I am studying this, so you should study that. So either failure or success of the parents, both of them are harmful by means of coercion to their generations. So this limitation, imitation, competition and coercion models are ruling the present education system. There is no desirability. And carried also, there is pseudo projection. What is pseudo projection? There may be one bus driver, or there may be one, for example, there may be one washerman. He must have become the chief minister, or a very great media icon, or he must be a very big person of celebrity, or he may be a person of illustrious nature in the society. And without understanding the methodologies and suitabilities to that exclusive model, the pseudo projection instigates the temptation of a lot of people to fall into the pit. For example, we are seeing only one success model. If in cinema somebody succeeds, in media, music or anything else, if somebody succeeds, we are seeing only one person who has succeeded. We are not seeing thousands of people who have been totally put into turmoil, the thousands more people who are struggling day by day. These things we are not projected in our mission. So, this pseudo projection of visualizing only few people, very infinitesimally negligible proportion of the society who are in the success rate. I am not telling these things to extinguish or to discourage the encouragement of the youngsters or the emerging society. Everything should be with proper planning and direction. That's what I want. It is not that to say that everybody with resources only can climb and ascend into the throne of success. I am not going to just generalize it or to make it exclusive to few people. It is possible for all. Provided one should have a strong base. One should, if somebody is to be lifted from the well, the person who is lifting must be strong in the base outside. Likewise, each and everybody tempting or trying for something else, they should have a strong base. So they can do these things. So it is not a pseudo projection in the society. This is not a scary. Apart from which, now there is a lot of friction in the relations of the families. Now the problem is, that's what I told in one seminar, disaster seminar. It is known as, I told that there is water crisis, there is oxygen crisis, there is energy crisis and also love crisis. Love crisis and relative disaster. We don't have relations at all. If we have, they are as disastrous as earthquakes. So this thing, relation, there is a problem in the society. Number one, in each and every family, the parents, either they are over rigid, they are exorbitantly rigid, are totally ignorant and negligent about the issues. And second thing, there is a generation gap. And the children must also be taught about the past and values so that they will, for example, this is G1, generation 1, this is generation 2. There is no possibility for this or this. We cannot expect all people to be so orthodoxic and antediluvian. We cannot expect all people to be ultra-modern. And this type of generation gap is to be removed only by understanding, not by changing their mannerisms and other things. So removing generation gap does not mean that the younger generation should have tuft and dhoti like this, or the ultra-modern t-shirt should be worn by our ancestors. It is not, it is not something connected with our dress. It is not connected with the attire, but our attitude and aptitude. So that must be a proper way. G1, G2, G2, G1 merge is very impossible. That can rarely occur. But there is a model suggested by great scholars. That is a comfortable status or stopgap between this G1 and G2 here. This older generation, they must understand what is contemporary status and what are the things that are required for the modern society and the trend they have to analyze. If they analyze to a proper limit, they will come here. And if these people, they can understand what are the values of our past and why they are also striving so. So a bilateral discussion and transformation reasonably and rationally that happens between these two generations will create both of them to halt in a salubrious midpoint, which will make this generation gap totally lubricated, resulting in proper way for development for both of the people. This is the real thing. So coming into relations, I told you in one seminar, and it was very humorously felt by everybody, but it is also humorous in nature because it is truth. One, there are only four relations. Your parents, brothers and sisters, wife and children. close relations. You disown your parents. Dispute with your brothers and sisters for these. Divorce your wife. You disown or distant from your children, or as a boomerang effect, you are disowned by your children. This is a modern psychic society. So, disown your parents, dispute with your brothers and sisters, divorce your wife, and you will be automatically disowned by your children, or you can make it distant. Is this the society we wanted? It is not a boomerang effect. In all things, you see, crushing the heads of agriculture, the founding industry, the developed mechanical industry. Crushing mechanical industry and that work IT industry flourished. And what happened? It is known as, that's what I told you in the seminar, it is the strength of the weak. You must not think that everybody is weak. They cannot directly attack you. The curse, the crave, the cry and call of innumerable people who are excruciatedly suffering due to hunger and insufficiency, that will reflect in the form of global inflation, superinflation, recession, everything, etc. It is nothing but the boomerang effect of whatever we have done. So either in health, wealth, or in relations, whatever we do, whatever we have done, knowingly or unknowingly, this birth or previous birth, whatever we get is boomerang effect. By understanding this, one can get a clear, one can get a clear vision about what we are going to do and what we have done already. So this impact analysis and self-subjection as well as self-rectification is possible only by understanding the rule of causality. This clarity is given only by our land. That is why it is known as Indian wisdom. Wisdom means it is only Indian. When we can say about Eastern knowledge, Eastern thinking, everything we can say. And whenever you say wisdom, wisdom is complete and completion is divine. And divine is something which is meant only for realization. Realization is only by penance. Penance is only through scriptures, and scriptures are born in our land. So Indian wisdom is the only appropriate rubric and help. No other thing to call or qualify wisdom with. So this is a problem with the relations. Then one more thing is sutra ki. There is a sutra. Sutra means string. I have already told in one seminar that you cannot expect everything as per your own demand or your own need. There is also one flexibility required. There are some qualities, special qualities known as sacrifice. Yes, I don't want that. Instead, everybody is conventionally getting things. Why can't I give? Everybody is gaining things and enjoying. Why can't I have the same pressure by using it for a productive cause? That is sacrifice. Second thing is contentment. Third thing is mercy. Fourth thing is flexibility. These are all the qualities which are essential. There is no strong, such a straight route in which we can be just assembling things and achieving things without any stopgap. There is no such thing at all. We must have flexibility so that we can adjust with people. We must have contentment in resources. We must have mercy towards other people also. And we must have the mentality of sacrifice as a positive replacement for avarice. It is a positive replacement for avarice, in which we love to lose more, in which we gain by losing. That type of sacrifice, that is the intuition of our land. And likewise, in this string theory of relation, like father, mother, children, then grandchildren, relations, friend circles, innumerable friend circles are there. So all of these people, they form a string in the society. Vasudhaiva Kutumbaka means that there is a string. Mahasutra. There you must have adjustment. You must have forgiving things, you must have the forgetting mentality. These type of qualities are very essential in the string theory, and it is not there. And coming to professional status, professional environment is a very competitive environment. We have competition, we have jealousy, we have competition, we have jealousy, we have domination, and we have discrimination. Office means we cannot say that, oh, it is ergonomically constructed, it is having rich infrastructure, everything is air conditioned and sophisticated machinery. We cannot think like that. We need not just imagine an office in which we get only salary, we do only work. Apart from the infrastructure, apart from your subordinates, superordinates and coordinates, you have to work with four more people as well now. You have to work with competition, jealousy, discrimination and domination. Those things are there. You must not just think that, oh, I am very loyal, I am very truthful. So loyalty and quality, they are not the mere essentials by which we can run the show. And even if you are good, there are three more possibilities. Associate, associated and merged. Even if you are proper, the associates, they need not be proper. And even if you are proper, the associated people with you personally, if they commit any blunder, that will come on your head. And merge, there is a total merge in the society, like most of the society, the major society is towards corruption and malpractices. But still, that's what I told in my seminar on ethics. What is the benefit of ethics? The benefit of ethics is not the favor of God, it is not getting a good birth, it is not getting into heaven or liberation. These things may be remote benefits. The benefit of ethicism is to be proud that we are ethical, that we are principled. That is the benefit of ethics. And going to heaven, liberation, getting divine sanction and embrace, these things are remote benefits. So we have to fulfill these things also. And coming into the real conclusion session, there are three insecurities. For life management, we must not only understand this resources side, we have to understand also the problems. It is known as problem analysis, success investigation and failure investigation. So there are three major hindrances for that. Number one is health insecurity, second is wealth insecurity, third thing is life insecurity. What is health insecurity? Due to mismanagement of resources, emotions and exercises or habits, we have got all diseases. Now whatever diseases, somebody asked, I think that Ganeshan, he asked, does somebody send a message for a normal delivery, seeking blessings for a normal delivery? Then I asked the question, what they meant by normal delivery? Then they told, without cesarean is normal delivery. Then I told that this is not the correct contemporary trend. Getting cesarean birth is a normal delivery, and if you don't get cesarean birth, that is abnormal delivery. So, diabetes, hypertension, hyperacidity, blood pressure, these things are occasional and rare diseases. These things were before few decades. Now it is very common and conventional. It is surprising and shocking to know if somebody is not having diabetes or blood pressure. So these things are common hazards. Then seasonal hazards, even seasonal, normal, now we are hearing new fevers, new viral attacks. A fever for 10 days that lasts for 2 months, and even after the fever has gone, 6 months of aftermath impact that touches us. So common hazards, seasonal hazards, and various infections and fatal diseases. So we don't have any health assurance. So there is a book written by a scientist, Efrald. He has written a book known as Death by Medicine. Most of the people, they die only by wrong diagnosis and wrong treatments. So there is a shloka also. Namastu bhyam vaidyaraya yamaraja sahodra. Yamastu harate pranam tvam pranam dharame vacha. Which says that doctor is the big brother of Lord Yama. And Yama captivates only the life, whereas the doctor takes the life as well as money. So this type of health insecurity is there. And second thing is wealth insecurity. We have fraudulence, we have acquisition, we have loss of wealth. Innumerable things are there for wealth also. In wealth also we are now developing a lot of things. One is, I have delivered a lecture on onto-economics. Certainly that must be distributed to all for understanding the real value of wealth. One is saving, second is insurance, third is standardization. We have to standardize the way of living. For example, to make a child to enter and complete LKG, the expenses incurred is as equal to a middle class family expenses. How we have to standardize, you see, where in a country, food and water, education, as well as medicine is sold, that is not the abode of luxury. So this thing, they must be minimized. It creates a bubble. How? See, if we have to pay more, not for luxuries, even for needs like medication, education, for internal perfection, you require education. For external peripheral perfection, you need medication. These both things are very great essentials for human life. So if there is, for shelter, for even food, for even education, medication, if it demands more wealth, then they have to work more, they have to earn more. More than their capability, more than their real brain value, they have to extend their elasticity and work. This creates a bulb. This bulb creates a bulge. This bulge creates a bubble. The bubble creates a burst. A lot of these bubbles, they burst in the society, creating global recession now. And coming to the third thing, life insecurity. Punarapi jananam, punarapi maranam. So this is the philosophy. Now it has become the part of human life. Any time we are ready to die at any cost, at any place due to any other factor, unpredictable factor, we are ready to die, we have to die. That's what I told you in seminar on terrorism. I told, if a city is not attacked by the terrorists, please don't think that the protection measures or the other vigilance and surveillance mechanisms of the city is safeguarding the city. Don't think like that. We are living by the mercy of the terrorists. If they are not attacking the city, means it is due to various other reasons, that they are preoccupied somewhere else. They have fixed a different date for the same place. And the third thing, they are now strengthening their resources, arms, ammunition and manpower. So these three things are the real thing. I am not joking at all. So life insecurity. There are accidents, explosions, disasters, suicide and homicides. If it is by some other intrusion, that is accident. If it is by this bomb and other thing, that is explosion. By nature, it is disaster. Somebody kills you, that is homicide. You don't want anybody to end your life. You end by yourself. Euthanasia, keep it. That is suicide. So these type of things are there. Either you are a target. For example, if I am a Hindu, you know, attack, that is targeted. Collateral damage. Aimless attack. What is collateral damage? Somebody is fighting just for the sake of being present in the atmosphere, the person is killed. That is collateral damage. Third thing is aimless attack. Common civilian attack, lot of people are destroyed. So this is a society. Apart from this, there are lot of day-to-day terrors. Dacoity, robbery, theft, intimidation, abuse of power. So we are living amidst lot of insecurities. What we can do? There are two things. We cannot transform or we cannot change these people. There are two options. One is reforming the victimizers. Our second thing is integrating the victims and strengthening their status to face these issues. How can we see? Lot of people are sitting here. How many of these are victimizers? Can we see the real targeted audience to teach the life management is terrorists, thugs, disruptive members of the society. Can we teach them? We will be retaught. We will go into the process of de-learning and relearning, and I will become a commander-in-chief to that community. So we cannot reform them. Then why we are teaching all of these things? Because of three reasons. One, the victims are suffering much because of lack of integrity. Those people are very limited in number. Qualitatively strong, but quantitatively they are weak. Terrorists are only 10 or 20 people. But immediately, these people, they are not ready for sacrifice. Even if the 40 people can kill 100 people, the other 900 people amidst 1,000 members of gang can captivate them and destroy them. But who wants to go in the front? Which 100 among the 1,000 is going to be the front is the debate or the issue with these 1,000 people. That is the problem. So one is to integrate the victims and to create a composite strength. That also we can do. Now number two, by educating the society, we can create awareness and prevent further such community being developed due to unemployment, poverty and misguidance in the society. We can prevent further community from entrusted to or from the embrace of the so-called pernicious members of the society. We can prevent the forthcoming generation. The third thing, a reasonable proportion of rehabilitation can be done with these people. So only for these three reasons, we are teaching all of these things. Now, coming to the practical session, what we are going to do? Number one, life management, I have already told, it must be customized. It cannot be generalized for all. It can be customized on four issues. One is to persons, second is for levels, third thing is for stages, and fourth thing for application. Persons means there are believers. We can only teach the believers. And non-believers we can teach. It will take some more time. It takes a different type of approach. Skeptics, atheists, rationalists, scientists, all of other various members of the society who think that these things are irrational or fictional or fallacious, they need a different design. They need a different methodology of approach. For common people, believers, number one. Number two, practitioners, we can teach more easily. And to surrenders, we can easily imbibe. All of the other essentials can be immediately taught, and such people who are having that impressionable mentality and ready to accept mind setup, we can just qualify them instantaneously and we can contribute more to them. And there are two types of surrenders, slothful surrenders. One is unilateral surrender and second is partial surrender. What is partial surrender? I want some benefit from you. I surrender you for some benefit. I am obedient to you to that level that I can get the benefit, but I am not fully obedient to you. That is, I won't listen to what you say, but I want what I want from you. This is not, this is what we have, you know, most of the people, they are not ready to obey and oblige, but they want some benefits from us. That is known as partial surrender. And the second surrender is unilateral surrender. If there is husband and wife, if there is a teacher and a student, there must be a bilateral mechanism which can qualify both of the people. And qualifying one end cannot produce the real wanted result. That is known as unilateral surrender. These are the problems. This is with persons. Second thing is the stages, at what stage we can do. One thing is incubative stage. Second thing is inceptive stage. Second thing is developing stage, then developed stage, then fatal or risky stage. So the stages also we have to analyze in the society for life management. And the third thing is the different levels of the society, individual level, family level, organization level, social level, national level, global level, innumerable level issues are there in the society for management. And for example, global management, if you say global management, there are issues like terrorism, there are issues like global warming and climate change. These things are global management issues. That we cannot put a small meeting between 10 or 50 people and we cannot decide anything constructively. We can formulate these issues and try to minimize. And we cannot do all of these things. And how to start this management issue from a person? First, think, note, notice, expose, minimize, avoid, control, and crush. These are all the 8 steps. First, you sit and think daily, just as you are writing your notes and other financial accounts and other things, you write the accounts of your behavior. Write also your demeanorial accounts. And then note how you are acting to the surroundings and think of yourself and note. And notice how others are behaving and notice how we can have an alternative behavior for that. And expose your real figure to people whenever you feel, whenever you repent for it. Then try to minimize, then avoid such circumstances, control it to the maximum and then end it with crushing. So there is a proper, there is also known as project ladder or executive ladder. In this executive ladder, we must start with thinking. Now we are thinking because we are in this environment. If we go out of the environment, we may think something else or we may not think about anything at all. So we must be having at least a routine of thinking of what the seeds have been sown today so that we can get all of these benefits. So, number one, the different levels and stages, whatever I have told, it can be of two aims on application. One is to manage your life, one. Number two, to manage the life of your dependents. Number three, to teach and guide others to manage their lives. One is independent, second is dependent, and third is guiding and teaching. So in applications also, first you must learn how to manage your life, then to your dependents, then how to teach and guide others for life management. What are the different ways for that? Number one, now due to the maturity and civilization of the present society, even the fourth standard child can know 100 times more about common sense and global incidental happenings than that of a mature person of 40 years before few decades. So that is easily possible. So now everybody is mature and civilized. We can understand things from common sense. Number two, education system. Development of science and technology. Fourth thing is good governance. And from our side, astrology. Astrology gives you proper guidance. If somebody believes in astrology, if somebody is a believable astrologer also, then one can seek the proper guidance for selection, matrimonial selection, then personal health hazards analysis. There is Jyotirvaidya, astromedicine. Astromedicine is there also. So matrimonial, educational, as well as professional selections and every other things can be possible by astrology also. Then there is religion, then there is philosophy, then there is mysticism. Astrology gives you the guidance what to do. Religion that adds the tips of observing worships and other forms. Philosophy that justifies the principles and their impacts. Mysticism that capacitates you to perform all of these things by which we can get the benefits. So these are the various things. Religion is very common and it is very proximate to us. Religion is very proximate, but religion is mismanaged now. Religion has taught earlier that everybody should be punished. And now we are learning that God can excuse us. And religion brand something as sin. And now modern religion, it says that you can do some remedy for that. So we are thinking that God will excuse all of our sins, and for all sins there are remedies. And this is Kali Yuga. It is known as era of errata. So in this yuga, it is very common. And even if you do want to do some repentance or something, you can do after 60 years. That is known as age fixation. Go for worship or to do some repentance, We can say, just as somebody told, yes, I can eat anything, I will monitor my sugar and I will accordingly put my insulin. Like that, they are fixing on age for depression also. I can do anything, and after 50, I will totally immerse myself in remedial mechanics. So these things are the modern religious teachings. So religion is a real way. It is one among the four pillars of life management. What are the four pillars? One is music, second is humor, third thing is worship, fourth thing is charity. If these four things are not there, apart from religion, there are three more things. Humor means there must be a decent humor. That is not a melancholic humor, laughing on somebody's problems. So it must be a decent humor. Music and other arts, that is aesthetic taste, apart from which worship. Worship and humor, see, there are two ways for exhausting your own self. One is by crying and second is by laughing. And worship is the way through crying. And humor or taste or any other aesthetic tool, that is by means of your humor as a thing. So, by crying and laughing, one can exhaust his burdens and be in his real status. And charity is also a lightener for one's own burden. So, by maintaining this worship, charity along with the taste in fine and performing arts, along with a decent sense of humor, is what we call real management of life. So that is what our philosophy and our other systems that have taught us. And the final point is, that's why our ancestors, they contemplated more on three things. Perfection of mind, perfection of intellect, and perfection of spirit. Why they have worked for the perfection of these things rather than science and technology? Because of three reasons. One is that goal, to attain God, unless a person's mind, intellect, and spirit, they are triangularly coordinated, one cannot be emancipated at all. So it is for their goal. Number two, even for other scientific, national, social, or any other development or progress, the base is a perfect mind, a sharp intellect, and a sound spirit, without which one cannot rejoice. Even if the rejoicement is there, that will be ephemeral. That cannot be all-round development, that cannot be permanent development at all. So serving as a base for other developments, we have mentioned that. So one is as a goal, second is as a base for other developments, third is considering the future. They understood that after thousands of years, at the era of Kali, at the advent of Kali, people will be totally lost from the pathway. They will be deviated from the arbitrary adhesion due to this. They will require some strong tool for mind precision, intellectual sharpening, and spiritual radiation. So considering our future also, they have given all of these things. So we have to make a syllabus and impart that knowledge to all of the other people. And there are five major hurdles due to which we cannot get into the benefit at all. Five major hurdles with our own self. One is, we are always saying one excuse, that is known as excuse of innocence. I have not studied this book, I do not know this thing. How you learnt Espanol, Chinese, German, English and other languages? How do you know about computer and typewriting? See, whenever you have understood that it is going to be fruitful for you, whenever it is going to fetch you dollars and currencies, then immediately you have voluntarily subjected towards learning of operation skills, linguistic skills and communication skills. Likewise, if you want to live, the excuse of innocence is inexcusable. So, number one, the first problem with us is the excuse of innocence. And number two is inceptive negligence. Whenever your problem is starting in the small level, this LTT, Osama Bin Laden, they started at a very small level, like a very grocery, small grocery shop. Now they are in a super complex model. When they started a small grocery shop, most of the people they supported, most of the people were mute spectators, now they are reaping the harvest. So negligence in the inceptive level is our second problem. That also we have to totally eradicate that thing. The third thing is double hold. We want to take the cough expectorant and also the ice cream. It is very impossible. Without sacrificing or without relinquishing the unwanted element inside you, no temple, no ritual or no receptor can purify. There is a possibility of you to impurify those status. That is a real possibility that may happen. So it is known as double grip. Fourth thing is blind jump. Blind jump, without knowing how we can do, immediately we jump into things. Tomorrow, some marriage, somebody told me, I am in deep trouble. I asked, what is the trouble? He told, I have fixed the marriage next month and I have to spend 20 lakhs. Well, we are fixing, you know the fact that you have to spend 20 lakhs. Then why you are done that? I don't know, it is the only daughter I have to do, somehow I have to do that. I am having some tension, what is the relief? So there is no relief at all, it is blind jump. And the fifth thing is predetermination. You have already determined something in your mind, already you are full. And we cannot re-pour or we cannot add anything to that. So these five problems are there with these people. The first thing is excuse of innocence, and second thing is inceptive negligence, third thing is blind jump, fourth thing is double hold, fifth thing is determination. Unless you people are ready to totally uproot all of these unwanted elements inside you, the divine nectar, the preceptorial gracious nectar cannot fulfill your demands, cannot fill your heart, cannot fill your spirit, and you cannot get the benefit at all. Considering this as an introduction to life management, I wish that somehow somebody should someday take a decision to frame a syllabus, perfect syllabus, with workshop methodologies, so that the life management can be taught to our people and transmitted to other parts of the world. I have already told, once again, India should take the global leadership, not by invasion, not by cultural infusion, but by its benevolent embrace of giving knowledge, support and love to the members of the globe. Narayan, Narayan, Narayan.